From the Library of Congress in Washington, D.C.
Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for being here. On behalf of the Chief of the Hispanic Division, Dr. Georgette Dorn, I would like to welcome you all to this very special event with saxophonist, composer, and educator Miguel Zenon. I am joined by my colleague from the Music Division, Larry Applebaum, who is Senior Music Reference Specialist in the Music Division. I am Talia Guzman Gonzalez, and I am a Reference Librarian and Luso-Brazilian Specialist in the Hispanic Division. Miguel Zenon was born and raised in the beautiful island of Puerto Rico, where he attended the Escuela Libre de Música. He received his bachelor's degree in jazz studies at Berklee College of Music and a master's degree in jazz performance from the Manhattan School of Music. But as we know, musicians test their chops collaborating with others, and the list of musicians Miguel has collaborated with is quite impressive. I will not name them all, of course, but they include Charlie Hayden, David Sanchez, Guillermo Klein, the Jeff Ballard Trio, Steve Coleman, and the Mingus Big Band, among many others. He has been a sideman in near 80 recordings. 15 of those recordings have been with the award-winning band SF Jazz Collective, of which Miguel is one of the founding members. Miguel has also led his own quartet for 15 years and has recorded 10 albums, with the highest praise by the press and the public, starting with Looking Forward in 2002, selected by the New York Times as the number one alternative jazz album of the year. His latest album, Típico, was released this year in February. I want to highlight just a couple of things from Miguel's outstanding and impressive career at such a young age, and we'll get to talk about many others in our conversation. Miguel Zenon is a recipient of a fellowship from the John Simon Guggenheim Foundation, which supported the recording of Esta Plena, hailed by critics in the US and Puerto Rico as one of the best recordings of 2009. It also received two Grammy nominations, one for Best Improvised Solo and one for Best Jazz Recording of the Year, as well as a Latin Grammy nomination for Best Latin Jazz Recording of the Year. Miguel was again nominated for a Grammy Award in 2012 for Best Large Jazz Ensemble Album and another Latin Grammy Award for Best Instrumental Album for Alma Adentro, the Puerto Rican songbook, which pays tribute to the compositions and explores the music of some of the great Puerto Rican composers, Bobby Capó, Tite Curé Alonso, Pedro Flores, Rafael Hernández, and Silvia Resach, and is my personal favorite album. His ninth album, Identities Are Changeable, also received a Grammy Award nomination in 2014 and was hailed by critics as one of the best jazz recordings of the year. Besides being an accomplished musician and composer, Miguel is also an educator and is a permanent faculty member of the New England Conservatory of Music. He has also taught and led workshops around the world, including the Band Center, Universidad Veracruzana, the Conservatory of Paris, among many others. In 2003, he was chosen by the Kennedy Center to teach and perform in West Africa as part of their Jazz Ambassadors program. And since 2011, he has led the program Caravana Cultural in Puerto Rico, and we'll be talking about that briefly. In 2008, Miguel received the prestigious MacArthur Fellowship, also known as the Genius Grant, for, and I quote from the fellowships page, for expanding the boundaries of Latin and jazz music through his elegant and innovative musical collages. In his work as a saxophonist and a composer, Zenon demonstrates an astonishing mastery of old and new jazz idioms, from Afro-Caribbean and Latin American rhythmical concepts to free avant-garde jazz. Miguel, welcome to the Library of Congress, and thank you for being here.
Thank you. Great to be here. Great to have you all here. Thank you.
For today's event, I will be asking Miguel a couple of questions, then my colleague Larry will be asking some others. We'll have an opportunity of Q&A, and there's a special treat of Miguel playing for us today as well. So we're in for a good time. So recently, Kevin Whitehead reviewed Tipico on Fresh Air, and he introduced you with the following words. He said, "There are lots of sides to Zenon's music that only begin with the complex insider-outsider status of the Puerto Rican jazz musician." So I would like to know, what drew you to sax as an instrument? And considering the music landscape in Puerto Rico in the 1980s and 1990s, what drew you to jazz specifically?
Like you mentioned, I went to the Escuela Libre de Música, which is sort of a performing arts middle school and high school in the capital of Puerto Rico. I went there for 6 years. And when I first started studying there, I kind of went in with the idea that I just wanted to play an instrument. You know, I didn't really have an instrument, a particular instrument in mind. For some reason, I was attracted to the piano. When I got there, I was about 11 years old. But when I got there, the first day when you enrolled on your instrument, everybody had the same idea as I did, of course, and all the piano spaces were taken. So I had to choose something else, and I think the options were like oboe, bassoon, guitar, saxophone. And I think there was someone in my family that had a saxophone lying around, and it just kind of made sense out of all those instruments. I was like, yeah, that kind of makes sense, maybe a saxophone. And of course, it eventually grew on me. But at first, I was more attracted to the idea of being able to play any instrument than to an instrument in particular. I was just attracted to music in general. And I went to that school for 6 years. It was all classical training, so there was no jazz at the school, obviously. There was some, I was exposed to a lot of popular music and dance music, and some of my early experiences as a professional musician was about 14, 15, were playing salsa music, merengue, you know, dance music. So that was kind of my early introduction to playing something that wasn't like chamber music. Mm-hmm. And then eventually, towards the end of my period at the school, I discovered jazz through friends in the school passing around tapes and talking about, you know, so-and-so, Charlie Parker, or it could be a Latin American musician like Paquito Rivera or someone like that. And I was really curious about the idea of improvisation at the time, because I had never been exposed to anything like that or had any formal kind of training. But I was really curious about it. And what did it for me at the time was hearing Charlie Parker play. Like hearing him, first time I heard him, I was blown away, not only because he played the same instrument I played, and he played it with such an amazing facility, you know, and great technical ability and dexterity and et cetera. But when I realized that he was improvising, that I was blown away, because I was like, how can you do that and still play the instrument that way? Mm-hmm. Like, you know, with such an amazing facility. So I sort of became, in a good way, obsessed about trying to understand what these musicians were doing. And I became, it literally changed my, discovering jazz music changed my life, because even though I have been studying music for a certain amount of years at the school, I was never like really serious about it. I never really considered the possibility of being a musician. You know, I was interested in other things. I was attracted to the natural sciences and other things, and I was probably going to follow that road somehow. But discovering jazz it really made me passionate about music. Mm-hmm. You know, and I had something I wanted to understand and discover. And from that point on, I just kind of, you know, it just became a goal of mine, and I just kind of embarked in that trip. You know, ever since then.
I'm sure you would have been a great scientist, but I'm glad you didn't. That chose the sax. Puerto Rican culture plays a central role in your compositions, right? And in a way, it is an archive of our musical traditions, música jíbara, plena, boleros. And at the same time, it's a laboratory where you experiment with combinations of sounds and rhythms to create something new. What compelled you to develop this concept in your own compositions?
So that process was also something that came later. I mean, after I I got really interested in jazz, and I realized that jazz, at least at that time, was not something that I could pursue in Puerto Rico. There were no higher education institutions at the time where I could study jazz, so I had to go somewhere else. And Berkeley in Boston at the time made sense, so I ended up going to Berkeley. And when I got to Berkeley, I realized fairly quickly that I was lacking a lot in terms of the sort of like the language of the jazz style, if you will, you know. So I had a lot of work to do, and I concentrated. I was really concentrated on really just trying to play jazz well, you know, studying the music, transcribing, listening, all the things that musicians do, you know, to try to get like immerse yourself in the style of music. And I wasn't writing any music, and I wasn't thinking about anything else that wasn't jazz music for about 2 or 3 years. About the time that I graduated Berkeley and I started writing a little music and kind of starting to think about what it was that I wanted, if I wrote music, what it was that I wanted my music to sound like, I realized that all these efforts that I put into studying jazz music was not something that I had done with Puerto Rican music. Basically, I realized that I knew jazz music better than Puerto Rican music because I had studied the history in a more systematic way. You know, I grew up in Puerto Rico, so I knew the sound of the music, but I couldn't explain it to somebody else if they asked me. So I decided that I wanted to be able to do that, and I sort of like, again, just went into this route, kind of like treating it almost as a research project and saying, okay, so what is this style of music? Where does it come from? What is its history? Different variations, how deep is the family, et cetera, et cetera. And as I would go into this different styles of music or subdivisions of culture or folklore, et cetera, a lot of those sounds started finding their way into some of the music that I was starting to write. And as I did it more and more, I realized that I would get a lot more from the research if I just focused on one theme, mm-hmm. you know. So it would be plena or Cubano music or the Puerto Rican songbook or some of the others. So that's a lot of my recording projects were born out of this interest to understand Puerto Rican music and Puerto Rico better, just mm-hmm. for my own sake. And I also feel that it just kind of helped me. I mean, I've been living in the United States for about 20 something years now, so it helped me connect to Puerto Rico from far. You know, just it helped me find a connection to my side of, you know, what made me a Puerto Rican and connecting to my country that way, using the music that way.
That's very interesting about the connections to the island, because your recording from 2014, Identities Are Changeable, right, explores precisely those links to that the diaspora has with the island and how we define what is to be Puerto Rican. Could you share with us how you approached this project and the role that the Puerto Rican community in Puerto Rico and the U.S. played and what inspired you, how they inspired you to create it?
So Identities Are Changeable is a project that was born out of, again, just a curiosity or me trying to understand a side of what it means to be Puerto Rican. And like I said, I've been living in the States for a long time, mostly in the New York City area. I have family in New York, like many of us Puerto Ricans do, and I've experienced sort of firsthand this idea of second and third generation Puerto Ricans outside of Puerto Rico and this kind of, this sort of rub that exists, you know, with Puerto Ricans in the island and Puerto Ricans outside of Puerto Rico, et cetera. So I was really curious about what this experience was like, because this experience was not my experience, you know, and I wanted to understand it better. So what I decided to do was, and this all came out of a initiative, a commission from Montclair University, and when they first approached me, I was like, okay, so now I can do this thing. And what I decided to do was interview a series of individuals, all of them second and third generation Puerto Ricans, all of them born and raised in or around the New York City area. That was kind of my first step. I just wanted to talk to them about their experience, about you know, how they felt as Puerto Ricans or New Yorkers or both, and their identity in general. As I went through the interviews and the questions and the getting deeper into the project, I started to think that what I wanted to do was use the interviews, like clips from the interviews basically, sort of interlaced with the music, to kind of give them their voice almost as an identity, like a musical identity, almost like as a soloist in a way. And that's what I ended up doing. I'm on the project. I was very new to this whole idea of trying to combine music with some other kind of multimedia art form. But I think ultimately what I ended up getting from the project, not only in terms of information for myself, but just trying to understand this idea better, was that I was able to think very differently about this idea of what national identity means to us as Puerto Ricans, and Puerto Ricans both in the island and outside of the island. And of course, I mean, I would say maybe 10 years ago, I had a very narrow-minded definition and vision of what this is. And now, after going through this process of this project, I think about it pretty much totally differently.
Besides your permanent position in the New England School of Music and the workshops and seminars that you teach around the world, you also have a project in Puerto Rico since 2011 called Caravana Cultural, which in a way sort of like gives you that other leg, you know, one leg here in the U.S. and then one other leg in Puerto Rico with that project. Could you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, definitely. So Caravana Cultural is a project that was born out of an interest of trying to use, in this case, jazz music, because it's what I do, as a platform to, you could say, sort of preach the importance of culture in society, and how this sort of cultural activities that are very, you know, they're not, at least to my eyes, that there's simple things, you know, music and art and all these things should be available to everyone. And I feel that a lot of the, a lot of places around the world that have done this really well have done this with a great amount of success. So I've always had this idea in mind of taking jazz music and taking it to places where it's not, where people are not as accustomed to seeing it or having it around, and just giving them the opportunity to be exposed. You know, I mean, I don't really see it as a way to, not really as a way of commercializing the music or opening up the gap to a wider audience or anything. I just feel that it's important for people to be exposed to as much as possible, and let them decide if it's something for them or not. So this idea became a reality in part with the help of this injection of funds from the MacArthur Foundation. And then in 2011, like you mentioned, we started putting together this concert. So what we do is pretty simple. We put together a free of charge a jazz concert in the rural areas of Puerto Rico, so everything outside of the sort of metropolitan area, San Juan and surrounding areas. And each concert is focused on a specific historical jazz figure, be it Miles Davis, John Coltrane, Charlie Parker, etc. We usually have, I mean, the locations, of course, we've been all over the place, even some of the, we've been to Vieques and some of those places too. And they vary from a theater to a school theater to, you know, I think we did one at the Lions Club, and it's been everywhere, you know. But that's part of the idea. We use what the community has at this disposal, and we have the concerts there, and people come out, and it's always a very mixed crowd, you know, from kids to older people and families, and it's really, really great. So as part of the thing, what we do is we put together the concert. Before the concert, we do a pre-concert talk where we talk about the history of jazz. We talk about the sort of like basic concepts of improvisation. So we give people sort of like a perspective about what they're about to hear, because most of the people, they always say, all the concerts that we do, about 75% of the public, they've never been to a jazz concert before, so we're trying to give them a little perspective. we talk about the music of the chosen composer, you know, be it Miles, or we talk about their life and the history, etc. And then we do the concert, and we always finish the concert by incorporating a group of young students from the community. And that's always, of course, the climax of the thing, because not only you know, you get to kind of like pass this on to a younger generation of young musicians who are interested in getting out there, but also I feel that it's important that the community, this communities feel that they're part of the project. Mm-hmm. That it's not just us coming in and playing and leaving, but they're adding something to it. And just a couple of years ago, we started giving out a little like scholarship, like a little grant to one of those students to play. So we give them a little money so they can buy instruments and take lessons and et cetera. And we've had, I think we've had maybe 11 or 12 concerts. I lost my count now, but I can definitely say that this has been the most, at least for me, the most rewarding experience that I've gotten out of music ever. You know, just this idea of just putting this concert together, not thinking about ticket sales, not thinking about publicity or anything, just go and play, and it's brought me back to this idea of the purity of the art form, the purity of music, and just being able to get there and play and connect with someone and have them just enjoy it for the sake of it. It's been really, for me, it's been super rewarding. Mm-hmm.
Would you say then that Caravana Cultura, to me at least, I see it as a vehicle that shows how music and culture in general is fundamental to everyone's daily life, right? And those people in those communities that don't see it also have a right to this, for sure. Would you say that music education is essential to the development also of a sense of citizenship or commitment, right? Social commitment to something?
No, I totally feel that way. I think, especially these days, this idea of having music and just cultural, artistic expression around us, especially as we're growing up, as we're young, I think it's not given the importance that it should be. Mm-hmm. And just going back to my education in Puerto Rico, and I went to a performing arts school and I became a musician, but a lot of my peers did not. You know, they became, you know, scientists and teachers and baseball players and all kinds of stuff. But when I see them now, I feel we have this connection because they went through the process of seeing music from the inside, you know, as performers and learning to play an instrument and getting through this artistic expression, even if it's something that they're not going to use as a way of making a living. It changed them, you know, and I feel that it's so important to give everyone or as many people as we can the opportunity to go through that process of seeing what it feels to create something from an artistic point of view. And I think that's why it's so important to have this available and have this out there. And I'm a firm sort of believer in this.
In your webpage, you have, which I invite you all to visit, it's pretty interesting. You have a section of other interests where you include literature, which gives us a glimpse into, you know, your broad interest in other cultural things. Could you tell us what role literature play in your music, if any? You have a recording also called Rayuela, which is pretty unique.
Yeah, well, you know, I do enjoy reading, and it's, I mean, it's something that I just enjoy for the sake of it, just like I like listening to music and everything else. This project that you mentioned, Rayuela, was unique in its own way because what I did was I focused on this Cortázar book along with this friend of mine who's from Paris, and it just kind of made sense because that's kind of like where the book kind of jumps back between Latin America and Paris, and we're trying to put something together, and that book just happened to be like the perfect sort of platform, and it just happens to be my favorite. So we tackled it in the way that we used the book as inspiration to write pieces and et cetera, et cetera. But it's not something that I usually do. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't I don't usually think about music that way. Meaning, let me see how to put this. When I write music, or when I'm thinking about music, I don't rely as much on random inspiration, and I deal with music more in a step by step kind of systematic way, where when I write something or when I'm practicing, I already kind of have a set of materials or tools that I already have with me. So I even though there is always some improvisation and of course some randomness, I try to rely very little on that aspect of it. So in that sense, if I'm reading a book, it's very rare that I'm gonna write a piece of music based on how that book made me feel. It's gonna be more likely that I'm gonna take a paragraph and try to translate that into musical terms somehow, and then write it more in that from that perspective.
And I have one last question before we move to Larry's portion. I want to ask something about Típico, which is your recent album. I saw the album cover, and I read the word Típico, which could be translated to folk music in a sense. And it's not exactly that, right? When you listen, it's not música típica in any sense. So why did you why that title, why Típico, and how is this term used in this project specifically?
So the title came from this idea of, like you say, when we, as Puerto Ricans or Latin American, when you hear típico or música típica, it usually means something that's folkloric or very, like down earth, you know, kind of thing, earthy kind of thing. And when I was thinking about this, and I was thinking about the meaning of it and what it means, I started thinking about how this could, at least in my eyes, could mean a style of music that's sort of connected with a very specific group of people, like música típica from Puerto Rico, and then you have típico from Cuba, and everybody has their own kind of way, and they could break up into different subgenres and all that. And this recording specifically, I was writing music that was inspired pretty much directly by my quartet and the members of the quartet. And I was thinking about, you know, writing pieces that represented our sound, that represented, you know, like how we've grown as a band, and this language that we've created together so we can communicate with each other. And I felt that was kind of our music, you know, and Típico in this case comes from that, you know, the title comes from something that's saying, this is our sound, this is the music that sort of represents us. And the cover is a great picture, which is from here. and I usually, you know, go through this process of trying to pick a cover, and I've been really getting into historical the pictures, especially those that are connected to Puerto Rico somehow. And I found this great picture by Luis Rossum, and then going through the filters, I found out that it was here, and the process was actually really simple and nice, and it's a great pick, so it just worked out perfectly.
Thank you. Well, I'm going to pass the mic to you, Mr. Larry. Thank you.
I like those questions.
Thank you, Larry.
And of course, the answers. I have many naive questions to ask, but even before we start those, I want to show you something and get your reaction to it. Let you put down the water.
You want me to hold the mic?
I want you to describe what you're seeing.
Hold on, maybe if I read it.
This is one of the treasures from our collection, from the music division.
This is Barbados, right?
Yeah.
But it's got a different title.
Right.
What's the title?
Kangaroo.
Oh, wow.
So this is in the hand of Charlie Parker.
Oh, my God. This is something else. You know, it's funny you show me this, because there's this rumor that goes around in the music world. I've heard it a couple times that Charlie Parker didn't know how to notate music, that he wasn't musically trained, like, you explain everything by ear and all that, so, and I'm always like, man, it's impossible, this, you could play that way, and like, and it's just great to see this, you know, it's amazing. let me see if I'm getting the notes right. No, this is something else. Wow.
That's what you can see. So I'm curious, because you mentioned Charlie Parker earlier. When you listen to an improvising saxophonist or any creative musician, what are you listening for?
Well, that's a good question. You know, I as an instrumentalist and someone that spends a lot of time playing an instrument, it's hard for me to disconnect from listening to music from that perspective, you know? So usually if I hear someone playing, especially if they're playing jazz, but if they're playing any music, I'm pretty much hearing like chords and notes and rhythm, you know, first. That's kind of like the first thing I hear. What key is this on? What notes are they playing? What's the beat? What's the feel? You know, that kind of stuff. But the music that I find usually attractive in terms of if I'm listening to an improviser, for example, or someone that's coming from a jazz perspective, I'm attracted to personality and sound. So and that's something that I work on myself, and I've always been really interested on this idea that the instrument is a reflection of our personality, and it's a reflection of the way our bodies are made, and because I'm an instrumentalist, I know how hard it is to attain and to get to a point where you get to that instrument to really be an extension of you. So when I hear Charlie Parker or Sonny Rollins, musicians of that caliber, and I hear that personality and their sound, that's the first thing that brings me in before what they're actually playing, you know. I'm really just saying this when speaking specifically about jazz music. I'm listening to a connection to the evolution of the tradition of jazz, you know, what connection do they have to the evolution of the language? And again, I think I might have mentioned this before, but when I think about jazz music, when I first started getting into this music, I realized fairly quickly that this was a language, first of all, and second, that it wasn't my language. So I had to kind of learn it from scratch, almost like learning to speak English in a way, you know. So when I hear players, be it older or more modern players, I'm listening for that connection, and it's easier for me to relate to someone that has a deeper connection or something that I can hear more clearly than someone that doesn't, you know. So if I hear that connection sort of right away, it's easier for me to relate.
So language is one thing. I want to ask you about sound, specifically your sound on the horn. When we learn to speak, we're not necessarily conscious of the sound of our voice, spoken voice. But I wonder how conscious is your sound on your horn?
I like to think about this in sort of like two ways. One way is the personality thing that I mentioned before, where we're really trying to portray something that's unique to us, and it's not gonna be like anyone else, even though you might be inspired by someone you admire, like in my case, Charlie Parker and Ornette and Coltrane and all these people, some Rollins that I like, and probably my sound is gonna be some kind of combination of that, or try to be a combination of that and other things that I like too. So that's one side of it, but that's, in my opinion, that's sort of like the easier side of it. The harder part is really being able to connect to the instrument physically. And as an instrumentalist, a lot of the things that we do and most of the time that we spend on the instrument is trying to make this connection as natural and seamless as possible. And that takes, it take a lifetime, of course. At least myself, I don't feel that when I pick up the instrument, the saxophone, it's not something that my body is naturally constructed to do. You know, I have to train myself to be able to actually produce a sound and a quality, good quality sound. So I have to use parts of my body when I play the saxophone and use them in a very specific way. I use them in a way that I don't use them doing anything else during my daily routine. I have to use my diaphragm in a very specific way, use my lungs in a very specific way, the muscles in my face, my embouchure, my oral cavity, my throat. That all kind of adds to that idea of being able to just produce a sound, like one note. So, to me, it's a balance between this physical, almost like an athlete fitness kind of thing, where you really need to be fit and shape in order to be able to produce a quality sound. And then once you can control that, then you try to embed that sound with personality. And like I said, this could take forever.
Was there a point at which you felt you had finally arrived at your own sound, your own musical identity?
There was definitely a point where I felt that I was in the right direction, that I felt that I had found something that worked, and I just kind of needed to, you know, finesse it a little bit.
There's a mysterious process, especially for jazz players, because so much of what they do involves improvisation. So here's one of my naive questions, is how did you learn to improvise?
Okay. So one thing about improvisation that's important to understand, and this is something, again, that helped me immensely, was to understand the difference between improvisation as a general concept and improvisation within a language, or within a musical language in this case. Like, for example, when I was in Puerto Rico and I was listening and mostly playing salsa music and listening to that music, the language that I was using to improvise within that music was very different than the language I would play if I was playing Barbados or Kangaroo. It was different because it's different languages, and I'm improvising on both cases, you know, but using a different language. Again, kind of going back to this idea of language and English and Spanish, I might be saying the same thing, but using a different language, and I'm improvising as I go, etc. So once that became clear to me, the next step for me was, okay, so I want to improvise, but I don't have enough words. I don't have enough language in this case, so I need to acquire more language. So I do that by listening, by transcribing, by immersing myself in this language, in this case, in the jazz language. And as I get myself more and more immersed in this language, a lot of these things that, you know, Charlie Parker played or Coleman Hawkins or Lester Young or whoever I liked and I checked out and I, you know, was influenced by, it starts as something that you basically repeat, it's repetition, and then eventually just becomes second nature. It's just, you internalize it and it becomes part of you. And the combinations of all those players eventually becomes your personality, along with your own ideas. I think there's a point where you, at least for myself, there was a point where when I started to look at a Charlie Parker composition or solo, and instead of necessarily repeating what he played, I would sort of like analyze what he played and saying, okay, so if he did this way on this chord sequence with these rhythms and these notes, that means that I could turn this around and do this differently, or take a couple notes out and still work. And you start building your own language on the idea of analysis and assimilation. And then eventually you use that language to improvise. So I see it more as improvisation is not necessarily, I mean, in this case, jazz improvisation, it's not necessarily you just go up and play whatever comes to your mind, but it's sort of like an organized improvisation. You're improvising on ideas that based on information that you've already gathered, and you're using that information to improvise.
I can hear that you are a somewhat analytic mm-hmm. person.
Yeah, you can say that.
Are you self-critical?
Yeah. Yeah, I can say that too.
So, when you're listening to your own music,
mm-hmm.
or really for any kind of music, what do you think makes a good solo?
Well, I think it's a little different when I'm listening to myself than when I'm listening to somebody else, someone else, especially for someone that I admire, and just someone, you know, like the Byrds and the Coltranes and all those, you know. I mean, a lot of those solos, I listen to them differently because they forge sort of like what I play. So it's harder for me to be critical. But with myself, when I, and a lot of, you know, a lot of my friends and me, I do this all the time where I record the concert and I go listen back and I, you know, I say, okay, so maybe this works and that doesn't work, both as a, you know, from a perspective of performance, as also perspective of just like a player or, you know, what I'm actually playing as an improviser. And I'm listening for things as basic as time, you know, intonation, sound, to interaction with other musicians. You know, I mean, am I actually reacting to what's around me, or am I just kind of going blindly and on my own kind of space? And I'm also trying to find, when I listen back to the list, I'm trying to find a connecting sort of thread through your improvised solo. You know, I'm trying to find something that you know, you hear this all the time, tells a story, and it's kind of that, but it's more, I like to think about it more from a perspective of, am I paying enough attention, not only to what's around me, but am I paying enough attention to what I'm playing so that I'm not just sort of rambling and I can actually use the ideas I'm putting out there to build on something that's logical and makes sense.
You teach also.
Mm-hmm.
Can you teach someone to swing?
I think so. I mean, I mean, it's not going to be the kind of thing where it's going to take 5 minutes. But
how would you do it?
I think it's like anything. You know, I mean, I think that kind of thing has to do with it's almost like if you teach, it's almost like learning an accent. Like if you're speaking a language, you learn an accent. You know, like. I was somewhere the other day and someone told me I had a New York accent and I was blown away by that. I was like, really? New York accent? I never even thought about that before. But it's almost like if you're teaching someone to learn a British accent or something like that, it kind of is the only way you can do that is by immersion, you know, by just listening and playing along and listening and playing along. And a lot of times what I end up saying, if I hear someone play, be it a drummer or a pianist, and I'm talking about a swing feel, for example, and I will say, you know, like your swing feel is too straight or it's too exaggerated, it's too strong, sometimes it's too much on the other side. So I would say something like that, you know, like I would say, okay, so your swing feel is too straight, so why don't you check out so-and-so, who's going to pull you to the other side, and if it's too much on the other side, then I'm going to say, okay, so you should be listening to this and this and this, and just like, you know, immersion and listening and transcription and try to find your place within those players. I mean, a lot of what we do as jazz musicians is trying to put ourselves in the place of musicians we admire. So we play along with records all the time. You know, we play along with records and trying to see, okay, so if I'm gonna play Lee Konitz solo or a Coltrane solo, I'm gonna put that record on, I'm gonna learn the solo, and I'm gonna try to phrase it exactly the same way. I'm gonna try to put the same swing feels, the same articulation, and in that sense, we're not only getting into the notes and the theory of it, but the actual feel of it, you know. So a lot of what we do in terms of learning feel and learning how to swing, be it in jazz, or in just learning how to make the music feel good, is by emulating what's out there, you know.
Talia was mentioning some of your, not just your accomplishments, but the awards you've received over the years. And I wonder, is recognition important to you?
Well, I like to think about it from a perspective of it's something that's important in terms of opening doors to opportunities. I mean, I definitely feel that things like the MacArthur Fellowship or the Guggenheim Fellowship and Grammy nominations, all those things, they give myself and my music more visibility and opens doors professionally, which makes me work more and makes my life easier. But on the other hand, I'm like you said, I'm self-critical, and I'm sort of a firm believer on being my own judge. I believe that I'm the person that's most capacitated to really say, really like accurately say what it is that I'm doing well and what I'm not doing well.
As a judge, are you forgiving?
Yeah, sure. I mean, it's the kind of thing. I'm not you know, I'm not gonna be totally flagellating myself or anything over solo, but I take a recognition in this kind of awards as something that's good. But even if it was something that was negative, like if it was a review and it's a negative review or a positive review, to me those things are basically at the end of the day they're opinions, and they have an effect, and they okay, so that's opinion, this is an opinion, but at the end of the day, I'm working sort of based on the work, the amount of effort and the amount of work that I still need to do. I mean, I always feel that there's always something that can be better, and it's probably just the way it's gonna be, and that's kind of how I put in my work.
You never stop learning.
No. That's right.
Yeah. So you mentioned Charlie Parker, and I know how important his music is to you. If he were here with us today, what would you like to ask him or talk to him about?
I would probably ask him about what he's practicing. It's funny you say that because there's this interview with Paul Desmond, which I'm sure you know.
Yeah.
It blows me away every time I hear it, because Paul Desmond's great saxophonist too. He's asking him about you know what he's playing, and I'm thinking this is probably like late 40s, early 50s, and this music was so new that you know to hear someone play that way is almost like someone inventing a whole new language, like within like a period of 2 years, and that language becoming it, like what everyone wanted to play like, and it was like the greatest thing, and still now I hear it and I'm like, wow, this is the greatest thing ever, you know. And on the interview he's talking to Charlie Parker about his practice routine, and it blew me away when Charlie Parker was talking about how much he practiced. At some point, you know, he said I might be practicing 10 to 11 hours a day, but a lot of what he was practicing were things that were really basic things, you know, scales, time, just assimilating solos. So I'm always interested on how, you know, musicians build their routines, you know, build their routines and build on things that are important to them, you know. So I would probably ask him something about his practice routine.
Mm-hmm. I'm very curious what your questions will be, and you'll have a chance to ask them in just a moment. I'll ask one last one, and that is, as a musician, composer, arranger, educator, as a father, how do you measure success?
It's hard to say. I mean, I think probably the way I would do it, and this is kind of how I think about this in general, when I started playing this music, and when I decided that I wanted to play, you know, be a musician for a living, I did it because my goal was to be able to play with people I admired, you know, with my heroes, and I've gotten to do that a bunch over the years, and I feel, you know, very lucky about that. I never really thought of music as a way of creating a platform for myself as a sort of like individual artist. I never thought about, okay, someday I'm gonna have my own band and my own records, and you know. And that, I mean, eventually that happened, and it's been a great experience too. But I usually measure in terms of the very small little jazz world here, I measure musicians sort of like in terms of who they play with, you know? And if I see a musician that's playing all, like with a bunch of people, I'm saying, okay, so that guy must be good, you know? And he's respected within the community, and he's, you know, first call for all these different projects. So that guy must have something that all these different musicians from different places are attracted to. So I feel that as I get to play with more musicians and I get to be more experienced, I feel good about that, you know, more than anything else, that I have some kind of connection to the community.
That said, you must be good. Okay, again, think about your questions, but, you know, I couldn't help but notice you have your horn behind you.
Yeah.
It's right behind the chair. I wonder if you can be persuaded to pull that bad boy out of the case.
I'll definitely play. I mean,
do you want to take questions first? Questions first?
Hey, whatever you want.
Maybe we'll do the questions first, if there are any, and then maybe I'll play with you. Yeah.
Who has a question? There's one right there.
I have a question for all of us amateur musicians and all the young people who are learning to play. How do you encourage people to be willing to take the chance and get up and play in front of other people?
Well, you know, that takes some courage, that's for sure, especially if you're just getting started and if you haven't had the experience. But I feel like it's like anything, you know, as you gain confidence in what you're doing, and that was my experience, you know. The more I practiced and the more I felt that I could do something like with a certain amount of comfort, it became a little easier to get up on stage and play in front of people. Of course, the first time I did it, I was terrified, and the second time a little less, and the third time a little less, and it just kind of goes like that. I've been doing this for a long time. But still, once in a while, you know, I'll get a little something, if maybe a family member in the audience or someone I admire, you know, and I get a little jitters here and there, but it becomes, after a while, if you do it enough, it becomes routine. It just becomes something that you're comfortable with, you know.
Who else? There's one right there.
Thank you so much for being here, and thank you to the organizers. I first saw you, I was in Ottawa 20 years ago, performing at the Blue Sally with David Sanchez, another very accomplished Puerto Rican musician. And I saw you last Saturday with David Sanchez side by side. So as a Puerto Rican myself, I've always been curious, how did you meet? And tell me a little bit about your collaborations over the years.
So David and I, we actually went to the same performing arts school in Puerto Rico, the Escuela Libre de Música. He went there, he's about 8 years older than I am, so he was there way before me, and I didn't meet him at the school, of course, but we went through the same filters, we had the same saxophone teacher, everything, you know. And of course, when I was at the school, when I was finishing up and getting into jazz, he was kind of like putting out his first record, so I was a great admirer of his work then, like when I was just getting started. Eventually, once I moved to Boston, I got really close with another Latin American musician, Danilo Perez, who's a Panamanian pianist and composer. And Danilo sort of became my mentor in Boston. You know, I would spend a lot of time with him and just go up to his house, take lessons, play with him a bunch. So I met David through Danilo. And while I was still in Boston, I still remember when we met at Danilo's place, we had dinner, and then David was playing that night. I came over and he you know, I sat in and played with him, and it was cool. And then eventually, when I was trying to figure out what to do after school, after Berkeley, some folks suggested maybe you should go to New York, and I said, okay, so maybe I'll try that. I had some family in New York, so that made sense at the time. I ended up going to school in New York, and when I was in New York, first thing I did was I called up David. You know, I was like, listen, you know, I'm in New York, and remember we met in Boston, and you know, and David basically did exactly the same thing that Danilo did. You know, I would just go over to his house, he became a mentor, I'd go up to his house, like, man, I'm kind of playing on this tune, you think you hear another line? I was like, so maybe I hear a counter line. We started doing that just for fun, And then it's like, you know, maybe we should play that at the gig tonight. Why don't you come over? And I went and we played. And then we did that a bunch. And it was like, okay, why don't you come on tour? And I did that and then started playing with them. So a relationship was born out of that sort of organic way. And just kind of going back to this idea of what that, you know, David and Danilo, they're very close friends. And they both played together for a long time with Dizzy Gillespie and a bunch of other bands. And to me, when I started getting into jazz, they represented what I wanted to achieve, not in terms of success or anything, but I felt that as Latin American musicians, they have been able, both of them, to get to a place where they could be respected as jazz musicians, you know, authentic jazz musicians, but at the same time, represent their culture, right? Both in the case of Danilo and David, they're both very connected to, you know, the music of their countries and trying to represent that through their music. And I felt really, I related to that idea very deeply, you know, and I related to the idea of making music that wasn't necessarily this sort of like instrumental dance music kind of thing, but more of a that have more of a balance between what I consider to be the essential elements of jazz, interaction, you know, this idea of taking risk and you know, letting things kind of flow and combining that with ideas that came from folklore and all this. And I felt the music at the time represented that, and that's kind of what I was trying to achieve. So it was really nice to cross paths with them and eventually, you know, becoming part of their inner circle in a way. So that was really great. Thank you.
Who else has a question? We have a question in the front row.
You have a question, Mommy?
It can be. Puede ser en español. It can be in Spanish.
Yeah. Dime, mi amor. Dile aquí el micrófono.
¿Quién escogió que ibas a ser un
músico?
Un músico.
Okay. Vete como yo contesto.
Great question.
Okay. That's a good question. The question is, who made the decision that I was going to become a musician? Eso es una buena pregunta.
It's a great.
So, I made that decision myself, but it was a hard decision because at first I wasn't sure. I was like, maybe I should do something else. I wanted to be an engineer. I wanted to study science and math, and I was interested in that as well. But I really loved music, and I really loved to play. So I said, I'm going to give it a try and see how it goes. And then if after a couple of years it doesn't feel good, maybe I'll go to the other thing. And then it felt good after a couple of years, so I was like, okay, I'll give it a couple more years and see. And then eventually I just kept going and it became what I do. Okay?
Can you say what you love about music?
you know, I really, when I first started playing music and playing, not necessarily playing jazz, but just playing an instrument, I like the fact that it felt like it felt like a game to me. Like I remember when I was playing music, I was also playing a lot of basketball at the time, and it felt the same way to me. It was almost like something that you do for fun. You can interact with others. You can, you know, portray your personality. You can be competitive, and you can, you know, do things to make yourself better. And you, even though I've been doing it for a long time, I still try to find that sort of like childlike mentality to it, where you just do it for them because it's fun and playful.
Beautiful. Who else has a question? No? Well, maybe now's the time.
I think they want to hear him.
Yeah, let's see what happens.
Let me see.
Thank you.
This has been a presentation of the Library of Congress. Visit us at loc.gov.